Good afternoon. Dean Bowman sends his regrets. He will actually be here pretty soon, but he is running behind. So we're going to go ahead and start the program, and I will do the welcoming remarks. I'm Josh Frasche. I'm the Associate Dean for Faculty Research and Development of the WVU College of Law. And it's my privilege to welcome you to our celebration in honor of Constitution Day. My colleague John Taylor will introduce our speaker in a moment, but first, a brief introduction to Constitution Day. West Virginia was not a state when the Constitution was drafted, signed, and ratified, but our state plays an important role in Constitution Day. So what is it all about? Well, Constitution Day is a federally mandated day of observance. Before 2004, it was called Citizenship Day, and it was an opportunity to honor and celebrate all those who had become U.S. citizens. In 2004, Robert Byrd of West Virginia added an amendment to the omnibus spending bill that year that renamed the bill Citizenship or Constitution Day and Citizenship Day, which recognized both our U.S. Constitution and those people who have become U.S. citizens. It requires that all publicly funded educational institutions as well as federal agencies provide educational programming on the history of the American Constitution on this day. September 17, 1787 was actually when the delegates to the Constitutional Convention signed the Constitution in Philadelphia, and that is the day we generally recognize as Constitution Day, but of course when it falls on a weekend, we pick an adjacent day, and so that brings us here. Though Constitution Day is federally mandated as a day of observance, it stays consistent with the ideals of our Constitution in that the law does not mandate any particular program or particular content. The program needs only to be educational and related to the Constitution and its history. This College of Law is certainly an appropriate place for us to recognize Constitution Day. More than half of the Constitution's framers were lawyers, and it's often lawyers and judges who take the lead in protecting the rights guaranteed by our Constitution. But the Constitution is no simple document. It was written in part as a political document, and it has remained a political document. Back in 1803, when Chief Justice John Marshall decided the iconic and politically charged Marbury versus Madison, it became clear that politics were forever to be ingrained as part of this Constitution and its interpretation. And that history is the focus of today's talk. To introduce our speaker today, please welcome WVU College of Law Jackson Kelly Professor of Law, John Taylor.
Good afternoon. I apologize for my voice because I'm sick, but I was really excited to have the chance to introduce Gerry, so I'm going to do it anyway. It's an honor and a privilege to introduce to you my good friend, colleague, and mentor, Gerry Ashdown. It's also something of a challenge. The first rule of introductions is no one came to listen to you, so sit down and shut up. Those who know me know that sitting down and shutting up is not my strength, and it's particularly difficult to do when the subject is Gerry Ashdown, about whom there's so very much to say. Gerald G. Ashdown is the James H. Buck and June M. Harless Professor of Law at WVU. He hails from the great state of Iowa, where he completed both his undergraduate and his law degrees at the University of Iowa. After brief stints in private practice and then teaching at his alma mater in Kentucky, he came to WVU and joined the faculty here in 1979. I'd never done the math before, but when I thought about it, I realized that you started teaching here when you were 13 years old, which is pretty damned impressive, though I'm not entirely surprised by that. Gerry is a man who is in all respects extremely good at his job. He is one of the smartest and most knowledgeable scholars I've ever met in law or any other field. He's widely published in the fields of criminal procedure, criminal law, and constitutional law. He's been cited by the United States Supreme Court on at least three occasions, twice in criminal procedure and once in election law. He's the lead author now in a widely used criminal law casebook, which he has substantially reworked over the years. In 2004, Gerry received the WVU Foundation Outstanding Teaching Award, which is a university-wide award, not just the law school. He is well known as the school's most thoroughgoing and skilled exponent of the Socratic method. All of us law teachers like to say that we're not just teaching the law, that we're trying to teach students how to think, but I think few people can lay claim to doing that as well as Gerry Ashdown does. Gerry is a great colleague. If he billed me for every hour that he saved me by answering my questions, he would be a very rich man. He's been a great friend and supporter of mine since the first day I walked in the door 14 years ago, and for that I will always be grateful. He has over the years given countless hours of service both to the college, the state, and to his community here in Morgantown. But of course, there is a good deal more to the legend of Gerry Ashdown than a man who is good at what he does. There is the wardrobe, the motorcycles, and of course, the stories. There are so, so many stories, and in my own mind, I have broken them down into the following by no means exhaustive categories. Number one, encounters with the law stories, which generally involve Gerry using the Socratic method on some unsuspecting police officer, or in some circumstances, turning to his wife, longtime Monongalia County Prosecutor Marsha Ashdown, and saying, badge time. Sometimes both in one story. There are the celebrity encounter stories, with an entire subcategory just devoted to Lyle Lovett. There are the things I said that Marsha told me not to say stories, as well as the things I did that Marsha told me not to do stories. The moral of all these stories is always, I should have listened to Marsha, but of course, I did not. Then there are the bike trip stories, the outdoor adventure stories. I could go on and on and on, but I won't, because it's time to shut up and sit down. A comment on a student evaluation sums it up best, and it's my favorite comment ever on student evaluations, and I read them all for 4 years when I was associate dean. The comment was simply this: how do you spell badass? Ashdown. Today, Gerry will be sharing with you his thoughts on judicial review in honor of Constitution Day. I'm sure I'm going to learn a lot, and you will too. Without further ado, the man, the legend, Gerry Ashdown.
Thanks, John. One thing that John didn't mention, because he probably doesn't know about it, when I first joined the faculty here, I taught at two other schools, and it came here in 1979. This is Chuck DeSalvo's favorite story. First faculty meeting, I raised my hand and made a comment, and one of the senior faculty members jumped up and said, "We don't allow students to talk at faculty meetings." And the dean at the time said, "Well, do you remember, Bill? We hired him last spring." I guess he didn't remember, but obviously I look fairly young, and obviously much older than that now. I'm going to talk a bit about the history behind Marbury here, and I tell my constitutional law students and federal court students this too. To understand this, you've got to put your head back about 200 years. I know it's hard to go back to the beginning of the 19th century and think about what was going on in the country then, because we're now in 2016 and we've lived with judicial review for over 200 years. But if you can try to do that, it helps, because none of this stuff that we think of now as a given was true then, at the time that Marshall decided the Marbury case. I need to tell you a little bit about the background of the case before I get into it. It came after the election of 1800, and the election of 1800, it was between the incumbent John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, and Aaron Burr. Jefferson won the popular vote, but the election was a tie in the Electoral College between Jefferson and Burr. Adams was a clear loser. Adams was the incumbent, a Federalist. And the House of Representatives eventually picked Jefferson as president. And he was to be inaugurated on March 4th, 1801. In the meantime, the holdover Federalist Congress, which was a lame duck Congress, decided they were going to pass some legislation to try to retain their power. And they passed a couple of statutes, one on February 13th, 1801, called the Circuit Court Act. And the Circuit Court Act reduced the number of Supreme Court justices from 6 to 5. So Jefferson wouldn't be able to appoint a new justice for one of the retiring justices at the time. Jefferson was a Republican, Democratic Republican, as they called themselves, which were essentially states' rights people. Adams, on the other hand, and his party were Federalists or more nationalists. So what they did in the Circuit Court Act is, in addition to that, reducing the size of the court, they created 16 new circuit judgeships, all of which would, of course, go to Federalists. Congress actually overturned that in 1802, but that's not the subject of the Marbury case. The Marbury case is based on the other statute that was passed by the holdover Federalist Congress. It was called the the Organic Act for the District of Columbia. And what it did is created 42 new justices of peace for the district. And of course, they were all likely to go to Federalists too. And I think it was on March 2nd, Adams made his nominations. This is like 2 days before the inauguration of Jefferson. Adams made his nominations, and they were confirmed by the Senate 1 day later on March 3rd. So you've only got 1 day left to deliver these 42 commissions. And John Marshall at the time was serving both as Adams' Secretary of State and the third Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court. He was appointed the third Chief Justice in January and served from January until March 4th as both Justice of the Peace, Chief Justice, and Adams' Secretary of State. So the nominations were made by Adams and confirmed by the Senate. Marshall, Secretary of State, and Chief Justice gave them to his brother, James, to deliver. Well, he only had 1 day to deliver them, and he didn't get them all delivered, obviously. There were four left undelivered, and of course, one of those was Marbury's, William Marbury's. And then when Jefferson was inaugurated, 1 day later, he told Madison, his new Secretary of State, not to deliver the undelivered commissions. And so Marbury, William Marbury, did not get his commission. And that's the basis of the suit, Marbury versus Madison. He filed an original action in the Supreme Court for a writ of mandamus ordering Madison to deliver his commission to him. His attorney at the time was Charles Lee, who was Adams' attorney general. So you can see how inbred this all was. I mean, if you think politics is rough and tumble now, I mean, you need to think back to the early part of the 19th century. It was every bit as bad then, if not worse. The only difference is we didn't have 24/7 news and social media, but they did shoot each other in duels. I'm referring to Aaron Burr shooting Hamilton in 1804 it involved the race for governor of New York. So there's a lot going on then, and so you have Marbury filing this action in the Supreme Court, and he based jurisdiction on a statute that was passed by Congress in 1789, the Judiciary Act of 1789, Section 13, which purported to grant the court original jurisdiction to issue writs of mandamus. And so that was his basis of jurisdiction. And Marshall got his hands on this case, Marbury versus Madison, as Chief Justice. And the first thing he should have done is recuse himself, right? Since he was the sitting Secretary of State as well as being the Chief Justice of the court. But he did not. He went ahead and heard the case along with his other colleagues. And they set three questions, and this gets into the heart of the case. The first question was, does Marbury have a right to the commission? And what Marshall said was, yes, he does have a right. And why does he have a right? Because the commissions were signed by the president and sealed by the Secretary of State. So they were signed and sealed, and consequently, Marbury had the right to the commission. Now, if you think the common law property law, he could have said signed, sealed, and delivered. Marbury would still have lost, but Marshall wouldn't have had his chance to rule on judicial review, so he simply said signed and sealed was enough, and then therefore Marbury had the right to this commission. The second question was, does Marbury have a remedy? And on the remedy question, he said that he did, because Congress had created this right to this commission. It had not been created by the president. It was something that Congress had created, and therefore Jefferson and Madison were required to deliver the commission. In the course of saying that, he said that there may be some things that are political over which the court wouldn't have any authority. And that was really the origin of the political question doctrine. But he said this is not one of those. This is not subject to the political review or choice of the executive. It's something that Congress created, and consequently, Marbury has this right to the commission from Jefferson and Madison. He could have said easily enough in the course of that that it's a political matter. If Jefferson doesn't want to deliver it, he doesn't have to. But he didn't say that. He said, no, that there was a right and a remedy, and that that Marbury had a remedy. So you can see what he's done already. He's not recused himself. He said signed and sealed was enough for the right, and that this was not a political matter, but something that that Jefferson and Madison were required by law to do. Well, then the next question was, and this is the important one, of course, because it deals with judicial review. He said, can he get the remedy from this court? And that's where he sets up this conflict that is the basis of judicial review today. And the first thing he did is he looked at Section 13 of the Judiciary Act on which Marbury had based the jurisdiction of the court, which purported to grant the court original jurisdiction to issue writs of mandamus. But if you look at that provision, most of you first-year students will get to look at it next year, next semester in constitutional law. That Section 13 actually begins talking about the appellate jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. And it easily could have been interpreted to mean that the court has the power to issue writs of mandamus when they otherwise had appellate jurisdiction. But he didn't read it that way. He read it to conclude that, no, it does authorize the Supreme Court to issue a writ of mandamus. So Marbury could file his action in the Supreme Court under that Judiciary Act of 1789. So then he examined the Constitution and looked at Article 3, Section 2, and this is the conflict that Marshall essentially concocted. If you look at Article 3, and I see some of my federal court students here, who I'm sure by now, Austin, have you read Article 3?
Yeah.
It's not very long. But what Article 3 does, it says it grants the Supreme Court original jurisdiction in the case of ambassadors, counsels, public ministers, counsels, or other cases where states are a party. So that's what original jurisdiction to the Supreme Court is given in Article 3, Section 2. Ambassadors, public ministers and councils, or cases where the states are a party. So he looked at that provision and he said, well, that doesn't include the power to issue writs of mandamus in a case like this. And so we've got a conflict. We've got a conflict between the way he interpreted Section 13, the statutory provision, and Article 3, Section 2, the constitutional provision, which he read as a ceiling beyond which Congress couldn't go. Now, here again, he could have read that as a floor. He didn't have to read it as a ceiling. He could have said that's the minimum amount of jurisdiction that the court has. Congress could go beyond that. But he didn't. He read that as a ceiling instead. And so what he's done now in interpreting the statute, Section 13 of the Judiciary Act, to allow the court to issue an original writ of mandamus, and interpreting Article 3, Section 2 as a ceiling beyond which Congress couldn't go, which they did in Section 13, he created this conflict between a statute that Congress had passed and the constitutional provision dealing with Supreme Court jurisdiction. And so that's where you get to the punchlines of Marbury versus Madison, because, and this is where you have to put your head back 200 years if you can do it. I know it's hard, but at this point, judicial review was by no means settled. And there were varying views on it, differences of opinion. The most forceful advocate for it was Hamilton in the Federalist Number 78. But it certainly wasn't settled. But what Marshall said in answering this final question, whether he could get the writ from the Supreme Court, he said, well, if you've got a statute and the Constitution in conflict, obviously the statute is void. Now, that doesn't seem terribly controversial, but it wasn't settled at the time. Statutes enacted by Congress that may arguably have been in conflict with the Constitution wouldn't have had to be void. The Constitution could have been read as a bunch of guiding principles and not hard and fast law that dominated over congressional enactments. That's not the most controversial part of the opinion, though. The most controversial part of it is when he said that it was the job of the court ultimately to make that determination as to which provision prevails and assume the job, a right of judicial review in that conclusion. And so he really conflated ordinary judicial review, applying and construing statutes, with this power of substantive constitutional judicial review, and ruled that the court was the final decision maker on that question. That was clearly not a foregone conclusion. It certainly was possible at the time that that Congress could decide on the constitutionality of its own acts, and the executive could as well, and it was not necessarily for the court to be the final decision maker on the acts of Congress or the executive branch. But Marshall, consistent with Hamilton's view in number 78, said that it was the courts, and so what Marshall did is have his cake and eat it too, and it was actually has been described as rejecting and assuming power in a single breath. Well, what does that mean? What that means is he rejected power because he ruled in favor of who? He ruled in favor of the Jefferson administration. Marbury didn't get his commission because the act on which he based his jurisdiction was unconstitutional. So he ruled against Marbury and essentially in favor of Jefferson and Madison, but he assumed power by this concept of judicial review that he established in Marbury versus Madison. Clearly, if he'd ruled in favor of Marbury, Jefferson would simply have ignored it, and Marshall knew that. He clearly knew that, that Jefferson and Madison wouldn't have followed any mandate from the Supreme Court on that issue. So he very cleverly set up this conflict. I mean, he could have ignored the case in a number of ways. He could have recused himself. He could have said it had to be delivered before there was a right to it. He could have said it was a political question. He could have construed Section 13 differently. He could have construed Article 3 differently. But he set it up and ruled in favor of Jefferson against Marbury in this decision in which he assumed this power of judicial review. To give you some idea of how tenuous that was at the time, the court didn't use it again to invalidate an act of Congress until over 50 years later in Dred Scott versus Sanford. They used it to invalidate acts of the states, and the court established that power in a case called Martin versus Hunter's Lessee in 1816. The most famous case probably that you'll read in constitutional law is McCulloch versus Maryland, where the court invalidated Maryland's attempts to regulate the Bank of the United States. So they used it in those ensuing 50 years to invalidate the acts of the states, but not to invalidate any other act of Congress because of the tenuous nature of what Marshall really had assumed in Marbury versus Madison. In fact, Oliver Wendell Holmes said, roughly 100 years later, that the country probably could have lived without Marbury, but it could not have lived without Martin. In other words, we could have gotten by, we'd have a different kind of government if there was no power of judicial review over acts of the other branches of the federal government, but we couldn't have lived without the court's ability to make federal law superior to that of the states. So if you think about this, again, the power wasn't used until the court got itself involved in a major political controversy in Dred Scott versus Sanford in 1857. And the court, I think at the time, Roger Tanning was the Chief Justice. And let me tell you what happened in Dred Scott versus Sanford. Dred Scott was a slave in Missouri who was taken by his owner to Illinois, which was a free state, and his owner died there. And so Scott sued Sanford, who was the administrator of his owner's estate, for his freedom. And he based jurisdiction on diversity of citizenship because Sanford was from New York. And in the context of that jurisdiction based on diversity of citizenship, the first thing that the court said, this is a 200-page opinion, it goes on forever. The first thing that the Chief Justice Taney said was, Scott couldn't sue as a citizen because slaves could never be citizens. The Constitution always considered them inferior to the dominant white race, and consequently they could not be citizens, and therefore there was no jurisdiction based on diversity of citizenship. That should have been the end of the matter. Jurisdiction is the first thing. If there's no jurisdiction, you stop. Well, Taney didn't stop there because he wanted to, I think the court thought they were finally going to settle rule on this question of slavery. So what Taney did is he went on to talk about and invalidate the Missouri Compromise. The Missouri Compromise, remember, Missouri came in as a slave state, but everything north of latitude 3630, slavery was abolished. And so what Taney said is that Congress couldn't abolish slavery because slaves could never be citizens, they never could be free, the Constitution never considered them to be free and have the same rights as the white race, and consequently Congress's effort to do this in the Missouri Compromise was unconstitutional. Again, we're talking 54 years after Barbary versus Madison. Well, I'm sure what the court thought at the time was that they were settling the issue of slavery once and for all, right? That they were going to use this power of judicial review to finally settle the issue of slavery that was being debated in the country very, very hotly at the time. It didn't settle it at all, of course, because what it did is inflame the abolitionists and embolden the secessionists, and of course, in part, led to the Civil War. So it gives you some insight into, you know, what when the court gets involved in a political issue, the impact it can have, and of course that was a very, very political issue. The court got right in the middle of that one. They arguably got behind public opinion and the political process in the late 19th, early 20th century when they started invalidating a number of congressional pieces of social welfare legislation. It really started in the late 19th century when they invalidated the Sherman Antitrust Act, but then took on more force in the beginning of the 20th century by invalidating a lot of the social welfare legislation that Congress had passed during the time, mainly dealing with wages, hours, and working conditions. The original case doing that was a case called Hammer versus Dagenhart, which was decided in 1918, I think. A child labor case, which prohibited child labor, essentially, between 14 and 16. It regulated the hours of child labor. The court invalidated that. They said, well, that's not commerce. Congress can't use the Commerce Clause to do that because production is not commerce, manufacturing is not commerce, and they ultimately said mining is not commerce. It all precedes commerce. So Congress couldn't use the commerce power in order to regulate things like wages, hours, and working conditions. That took on full force, really, during the New Deal, when this whole, actually, is a court made up of fairly old men, and what their politics at the time was that of laissez-faire. In other words, the government should stay out of the interests of business and not try to regulate the market, what we call free market economics now, but that's where the politics of a majority of the Supreme Court was at the time, and they clearly by the time we got to the 30s and the Depression were behind the public opinion and the political process. So they lagged behind. The court in Dred Scott actually got in the middle of it. Here they're actually lagging behind the political process. The court invalidated a lot of the New Deal legislation, the Railroad Retirement Act and the Alton case, the National Industrial Recovery Act and Schechter Poultry, the Bituminous Coal Conservation Act and Carter versus Carter Coal. And that's what led, in terms of politics, that's what led, and I'm sure you all heard of this, Franklin Roosevelt, FDR, to propose his court packing plan. For those of you who don't know about the court packing plan, what FDR wanted to do, he wanted to put another justice on the court for every one that was over 70 who refused to retire. At the time, that would have allowed FDR to appoint 6 new members to the court, and which of course would have given him a majority on the court to rule on this New Deal legislation coming out of the 30s. Well, the Senate never bought it. They thought it would undermine the independence of the court. But as it turned out, FDR didn't need it because of two reasons. I mean, there's two possible explanations for that. There's one that's clearly true. The first one is that debate over Owen Roberts. Owen Roberts was one of the 5 members of the 5 justice majority who voted to invalidate all this New Deal legislation. In 1937, he changed his votes in a couple of cases. One of those dealt with the National Labor Relations Act. NLRB versus Jones and Laughlin Steele is the name of the case. So he changed sides and made a 5-justice majority to uphold the NLRB, the National Labor Relations Act. He did the same thing in regard to state legislation. I mean, the court was doing the same thing to state legislation, not under the Commerce Clause, but under the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment, saying that there was this substantive component to due process. And part of that substantive component was this freedom of contract. And if the states, now not Congress using the commerce power, but the states tried to somehow interfere with this freedom of contract, it violated the Due Process Clause. The most famous case there, I'm sure you've all heard of, is Lochner versus New York, which invalidated an attempt to regulate hours, wages, and working conditions in the New York poultry business. Bakery business, I'm sorry. Schechter Poultry is the poultry case. Lochner is the bakery case where Congress, the state of New York, attempted to regulate the wages, hours, and working conditions of bakers. And the court struck it down as interference with this freedom of contract. As it turned out, though, FDR didn't really need Robert's vote. And I'll tell you why. And this is the real reason why you get the switch in terms of politics and how the court decides cases. Between 1937 and 1941, FDR got 7 new appointments to the court. Among those, Black, Douglas, Frankfurter, and his former Attorney General, Robert Jackson, plus 3 others, which clearly gave him a huge majority on the court to uphold his suggested legislation, New Deal legislation. And of course, the court continued to validate Congress's attempt to use the Commerce Clause and the state's attempts to regulate hours, wages, and working conditions in their own borders. In fact, the Commerce Clause got so expansive, your first-year students will study this next semester, it got so expansive that the court held in a case called Wickard versus Filburn that that Congress could actually regulate the home consumption of wheat, even though it was never passed the borders of the state. Under the theory, well, yeah, but the market is so broad that if this particular farmer is using his homegrown wheat, it's going to affect the supply and demand in the market, and consequently, Congress could use its commerce power and Agricultural Adjustment Act to regulate what was a quota for homegrown use of stuff grown on the farm. The commerce power got so broad, in fact, that the court upheld its use in the context of civil rights legislation. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 upheld its use to prohibit racial discrimination in Heart of Atlanta Hotel versus United States and Katzenbach versus McClung under the theory that, well, if hotels and restaurants, motels were discriminating on the basis of race, that interfered with interstate travel and food going in and out of the state. And consequently, Congress could use its commerce power to do that. And so you have a major political change after 1941 in this court, which was led by FDR's appointments. And of course, shortly after that, you get into the 50s. And no one could mention the 50s without thinking of Earl Warren, right? Earl Warren was appointed by Eisenhower in the summer of 1953. Let me give you a little background of how Earl Warren got on the court. The court had granted review in 5 cases from the 4 states, and I think it was the District of Columbia, on the question of segregation in the public schools in the late 19th century in Plessy versus Ferguson. I'm sure you all heard Plessy versus Ferguson, where the Supreme Court had upheld separate but equal in the context of railroad cars, railroads. They'd have separate facilities for whites and blacks. And they'd upheld that in the context of public schools as well. And in 1952, the court granted review on that question of segregation in the public schools in those 5 cases. And the case was argued in 1952, and the court couldn't reach a decision, and so they held it over for argument to the next term, the 1953 term. Douglas says in his autobiography that if they had voted on that at the time, They only had 4 votes to overrule Plessy. And so the court would have upheld Plessy versus Ferguson in 1952 had they voted and not held it over to the next term. Well, they held it over for the next term, and the reason they wanted to investigate what the intent of Congress was in passing the 14th Amendment. In the meantime, in the summer of 1952, Chief Justice Fred Vincent died of a heart attack. And because of his death, Eisenhower, president at the time, appointed Earl Warren, who was governor of the state of California, to be Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court. In fact, there's a quote from Frankfurter that says, "The only clear evidence I ever had that there was a God," because he got a new Chief Justice instead of Fred Vinson. And what happened after that is, through intense lobbying, Earl Warren got the court to unanimously vote to overrule Plessy, and of course, Brown versus the Board of Education, which I'm sure you've all heard of and should be well aware of by now, which invalidated segregation in the public schools. That's not the only thing the Warren Court did. I mean, it did a lot of other stuff as well. John knows this as well as I. In the area of criminal procedure, when you take criminal procedure in your second and third year, you'll find out that the Warren Court drastically revolutionized criminal procedure by constitutionalizing it. You're back in the late 50s and 60s, the height of the civil rights movement, and you get the states mistreating their defendants by not giving them certain rights in the criminal process. And so the Warren Court stepped in, mainly in the late 50s and 60s, to make the Bill of Rights applicable to the states and the provisions dealing with criminal procedure. If you look at the Bill of Rights, there are 15 separate rights in the first 8 amendments that deal with the criminal process. And what the court did was say that those specific rights, the right to counsel, the right to jury trial, the protection from unreasonable search and seizures, the privilege against self-incrimination, all of those things were applicable to the states as part of 14th Amendment due process, carrying with it all the federal decisions that interpreted those rights. What are the most famous of those cases? Well, if you think back, Mapp versus Ohio, 1961, which applied the exclusionary rule to the states. The exclusionary rule is the rule that says if evidence is illegally seized, you can't use it in a criminal trial. That wasn't applicable to the states until the court decided Mapp in 1961. Then you get Gideon versus Wainwright in 1963, in which the court said that anybody who couldn't afford a lawyer had a right to court-appointed attorney in a felony case. You've probably all heard of Gideon versus Wainwright, I think, the 1963 decision, which required that attorneys be provided to folks who were indigent, couldn't afford lawyers in felony cases. One of the cases I'll mention, and I don't need to describe it because I know you all know what it is, Miranda versus Arizona, right? We all know what Miranda is, right? The warnings that have to be given to a defendant in the context of a custodial interrogation. That was 1967, and there are a lot of other cases I could mention that do other things. Those are probably the most famous 3. But again, you get the court heavily involved in trying to regulate the political process, public opinion, the political process, in sometimes moving it, not necessarily getting in the middle of one, like in Dred Scott, or behind in the late 19th, early 20th century in this New Deal, in the New Deal legislation. But sometimes the court might even got ahead of the political process. The other thing the Warren Court did is reactivate substantive due process, not in the context of freedom of contract, but in the context of fundamental rights, individual rights. That happened initially, at least in the Warren era, in a case called Griswold versus Connecticut, where the court said that states could essentially not outlaw the use of contraceptives based on this right to make decisions about procreation. And that case was the forerunner of the later decision, again, I'm sure you're all aware of Roe versus Wade in 1973, where the court held that a woman has the right to choose of whether or not to have an abortion. And I say that the court may have got out ahead of the political process then, because there was a lot of debate in the country about whether or not that should be, abortion laws should be eliminated, repealed. There's a lot of commentary about Roe versus Wade that says it was great politics but bad constitutional law. And so the court may have gotten out ahead of itself a little bit, and I know that one of my colleagues, Jim McLaughlin, here thinks that's the case, and a lot of other constitutional scholars do too. But the courts never overruled Roe versus Wade, as you know, and it's actually been the forerunner of more recent cases dealing with gay rights. Lawrence versus Texas, I don't know if you've heard of that. That's a case that prohibits the regulation of sexual behavior between consenting adults in private. Two gay men in that case, came out of Texas. The more recent cases, of course, deal with gay rights. The Windsor case, which invalidated DOMA, the Defense of Marriage Act, and in the more recent case, last term of Obergefell versus Hodges, which invalidated state laws which prohibited gay marriage. And in fact, in the Obergefell case, Kennedy actually responded to the issue of whether the court was getting out ahead of itself in using the due process clause of the 14th Amendment and not letting the political processes play out. And he simply said sometimes the political process was too slow, and it was too slow to protect fundamental rights, and that's where the court had to step in. You know, and that's essentially the position the court took in cases like Griswold, Roe, and these cases dealing with gay and lesbian rights. Well, where does that leave us? I'm running short of time here, but I want to come up to contemporary times a bit and talk about where we are now. You know, at the end of the 20th, beginning of the 21st century, we've essentially had a conservative court. In the late 20th century, it was Chief Justice Rehnquist, O'Connor, Kennedy, Scalia, and Thomas. And now what you have is about the same five-justice majority, but different justices, Roberts, Kennedy, Scalia, Thomas, and Alito. But you still have, in many cases, a 5-4 conservative majority, and which you've done of, and Kennedy has been a swing man, as you all I'm sure know, in some of these cases, like in the Obergefell case, in the gay rights cases, he's been very staunchly in favor of protecting those fundamental rights of sexual activity and freedom of association. What's this court done? What's the court done in contemporary times, beginning in, the late 20th, early 21st century, this 5-4 majority? I want to mention three cases, not because this is the only time you have this 5-4 majority. The other side of the court was generally led by initially Justice Brennan, then Justice Stevens. And now you have a 4-justice minority in many of these cases, Justice Breyer and the three ladies on the court. So what's happened recently? And the reason I raise that issue is because I want to suggest what's likely to happen. I'm going to mention three cases. There are others I could pick. These are just the ones I picked because they stand out. The first one is one I'm sure you've never heard of. It's called Seminole Tribe of Florida versus Florida. And another case called Alden versus Maine. And what the court did in those cases is essentially say that Congress, although Congress could regulate the states, they couldn't make them beholden to suit in either the federal or state courts. In other words, even if they violated federal statutes, there was no individual remedy. You couldn't sue the states for damages. The Seminole Tribe case dealt with something called the Indian Regulatory Gaming Act. I'm sure some of you've been on reservations and you see these casinos. That's the result of the Indian Regulatory Gaming Act. The state of Florida refused to deal with the Seminole Tribe, and so they sued the state of Florida in federal court, and the case got to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said, no, the state cannot be sued in federal court because the states have sovereign immunity. So they're not subject to being sued in federal court or in state court. That's the later case of Alden versus Maine, which essentially means that you can't make the states responsible for violations of federal law, at least not by individual lawsuits. That's the Indian Regulatory Act was involved in Seminole Tribe, but some of the later cases deal with the Americans with Disabilities Act, the Age Discrimination and Employment Act, meaning the states could violate them, but you can't sue them. That case, at least in the federal courts context, is very significant. It's probably a case that you haven't heard of, but it's one I wanted to mention. The two others, that I think are significant are the gun control cases, Heller and McDonald. Let me back up for just a second. The reason you got the change in Seminole Tribe from the court's earlier precedent, the earlier precedent said that Congress could, in fact, make the states responsible for violation of federal law in federal court. They overruled that in that Seminole Tribe case, largely because Thomas took Marshall's seat. One justice changed a 5-4 decision another way. The gun control cases also were 5-4 majority cases, with Scalia and Alito writing the opinions. Those gun control cases overruled probably anywhere from 50 to 80 years of Supreme Court precedent, saying the Second Amendment only applied to service in the militia. And there are probably 6 cases over the course of history that have said that. In the Heller case versus the District of Columbia, District of Columbia versus Heller, the court looked at the history behind that, Scalia's opinion, and said, no, the militia clause is only a prefatory clause. The operative clause is really the one on the right to bear arms, and they're 2 separate clauses, and therefore citizens have the right to own weapons for self-protection. And of course, that was followed. They applied that Second Amendment decision to the states in the McDonald case and overturned Chicago's restriction on the ownership of handguns. And the thing that the district had done and that Chicago had done is they virtually totally eliminated, prohibited the possession of handguns. You couldn't own one. Of course, that's all been overturned now because of Heller and McDonald. The last case I want to mention, and it's the one that's most controversial, at least for most people, except maybe my colleague Bob Bastris, who's I think here somewhere, who's a First Amendment absolutist. But I'm sure you've all heard of Citizens United versus the Federal Election Commission. I'd be surprised if you haven't by now. What the court did in that case, I'll have to back up for a second, because back in the early 70s, the court decided a case called Buckley versus Vallejo. It dealt with the Federal Election Campaign Act of 1970, where Congress put severe restrictions on campaign contributions and expenditures. The court, for the most part, in that old Buckley case, upheld limitations on contributions, but invalidated limitations on expenditures by saying, essentially, that money is speech. I've never agreed with that, but that's what the court held. This is back in 1976, I believe. So the Buckley case has been around for a long time, but restrictions on corporate speech have been imposed in a number of different enactments, both at the federal and state level, under the theory that you've got a real potential there for corruption or the appearance of corruption or the distorting effect of corporate money that could have on campaigns and elections. But in that Citizens United case, the court overruled a couple of cases that had upheld restrictions on corporate speech and essentially said, no, corporations, and by implication unions, are citizens entitled to the protections of Buckley versus Vallejo, and struck down any limits placed on corporate expenditures. You know the effect that that's had on politics. Congress passed that bipartisan Campaign Expenditure Reform Act, I think, in 2002, which is part of what was struck down in the Citizens United case. Well, why do I mention those cases? I'm running short of time here. The reason I mention them is because those are the three I would pick if I thought a different court would do something else. My guess is if you got a different court, in other words, we all know that Justice Scalia sadly passed away a short time ago. And so there's an opening on the court now. The court is essentially tied 4-4, which makes this election enormously important, at least for scholars of constitutional law and criminal procedure in federal courts. If the Democrats get the White House, if Hillary Clinton wins, she's going to appoint somebody to the court, and if it's somebody like a Justice Obama, which I've heard thrown around, or somebody like him, not Merrick Garland, but somebody much more progressive than that, those are my three picks for the first three cases the court will overrule. And my guess is they'll do it quickly. Maybe not so quick with Seminole Tribe, But the Heller, McDonald, and Citizens United cases, I think, would go fairly rapidly. And what the court does, they don't come out and just say, "Oh, the court was full of shit. You know, we changed our minds." You know, they're more diplomatic than that. They use these arts of overruling, right? They say, "Oh, we have inconsistent precedents," or "This case hasn't withstood the test of time," or "It was poorly reasoned." I mean, there are these ways of saying it in a political fashion that doesn't sound like you just got to change injustices. Even though in terms of these cases I've just mentioned, these three, in one case you had to change from Marshall to Thomas, in the other case you had to change from O'Connor to Alito. Those are the election case. I mean, the Citizens United case largely was based on O'Connor being replaced by Justice Samuel Alito. So it only takes one vote, and if you get a different, if you get a Democratic president, my suspicion is you'll have a lot of activity with respect to certain cases, and those are my picks. So I guess I hope I've disabused you of the notion that politics is not involved in Supreme Court decision making, because it clearly is. Well, thanks. I'm willing to take questions if anybody has any, and if there's time to do it. I'll have to offer this caveat now, though, before you start asking me questions. I haven't taught constitutional law for 3 years, so I've moved away from it for a little bit, and so it's not as fresh in my head as it was, 2012 or so, 2013. But I'm willing to answer questions if anybody has any, or try to answer them. Sir. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
I'm sort of frustrated with the 4-4 tie right now in the Supreme Court. So I'm just wondering, is there any power that the Supreme Court can use to like invoke like a rule where they can keep an odd number whenever they want to have like somebody sit out every so often?
Congress. Congress has the power to set the number of justices on the court. Now, the Constitution doesn't say that, but it's always been assumed that Congress has had the power. Congress has the power by virtue of Article 3, Sections 1 and 2, to control the jurisdiction of the federal courts. This is about a third of my class in federal court, so I won't go into it. But they do have the power to regulate the jurisdiction of the federal courts, including the Supreme Court. The Constitution says nothing about the number of justices on the court, but Congress has always assumed it had the power to set that number. It's been as low as 5 and as high as 10. And it was settled at 9 right after the Civil War and been there ever since. So Congress could do that. I mean, they could drop the size of the court from 9 to 8. Politically, probably not feasible. But it could be 9, it could be 10, it could be 7. You know. The Constitution, again, says nothing about that. So, you know, it's something that Congress has always assumed they had the power to do. Like in Marbury, you know, like Congress reduced the size of the court from 6 to 5, so Jefferson would not get another appointment to the court. Jefferson being a Republican and the Federalists not wanting the Republicans to take control of the court. Republican was used in a different way back in those days than it is now, but does that answer the question? And the court can't do it, but Congress could. Anything else? I knew you'd ask a question.
I'm just curious. I don't disagree with the notion that if cases are going to be overruled, those would be ones that would be likely to be overruled if it's going to happen. But I think I'm less. I think I'm more skeptical of the idea that it's going to happen. Boom, boom. And indeed, in Ginsburg's kind of ill-advised interview about Trump and so forth, she said something like, "Oh, I'd love to see Citizens United overrule, but I don't think it's going to happen." So, I mean, why do you? I mean, maybe she's just being coy, but I mean, why do you think it's going
to
happen?
I think it depends, John, on who gets appointed to the court. I mean, look what happened between the first argument in Brown versus the Board of Education in 1952, right, and what you get once you get Earl Warren appointed Chief Justice. If you got somebody, and I don't think this is beyond the realm of possibility that Hillary gets elected and she nominates Obama to the court. Now, would he take it? I don't know. Would he want it? I don't know. Could Congress refuse to confirm him? I don't think so. It wouldn't be a bad political move. But if you got somebody like that on the court with that kind of background experience and prestige who could lobby intensely, I'm not so sure it couldn't happen sooner rather than later. I think if you're a betting person, you'd have to say, yeah, they might overrule them, they might do it, but it'd be a while.
What if Trump gets elected? What cases will be overruled?
Well, I mean, the one that comes to mind would be Obergefell versus Hodges. I mean, that would be one that you'd have to assume, Roe versus Wade, maybe.
You don't assume that Heller versus, that Heller case would be
Not by a Republican appointee.
No, but by a Democrat.
Oh, I think it would be.
Heller would get
overruled? I think it could be, yeah. I mean, if you read those opinions in that Heller case, the Scalia opinion versus the Stevens opinion, I mean, they cite exactly the same sources. And they use the same arguments, but come to completely different conclusions. That would be an easy case to overrule, based on the opinion you have, Scalia's opinion and Stevens' dissenting opinion, for the other four members of the court.
Well, Ginsburg has also said that she thinks the court feels very strongly about not overruling precedent at all. And I think maybe she's saying she doesn't like overruling precedent because there's a theme in what she says about precedent that keeps rolling around this idea that we're not going to overrule. So don't worry, Roe v. Wade's not going anywhere. There may be chipping away, but it's not actually going to be overruled. So while she's on the court, and because she's been on the court for so long, she may argue against straight up overruling precedent, but maybe figuring a way to, sort of, I don't know that you can actually work around Heller. I mean, it's so clear. Work around Citizens United, but she might figure out a way to hamstring those cases without overruling precedent.
Well, in fairness to that point, I mean, there's a lot of ways to deal with Heller short of overruling it. Because all the court said in Heller is that citizens have the right to use guns in a home for self-defense. And they made it clear, Scalia's opinion makes it clear, that they're not outlawing all kinds of gun regulation. And the court really has not touched many of these gun regulation cases. They simply denied review in the cases. So, one thing that could happen without overruling Heller, you could get the court willing to uphold a lot of other restrictions on gun rights, except for, you got the National Rifle Association doing the lobbying in Congress, so the question is whether you get that kind of thing. The state level, I think you're more likely to get gun regulation.
Let me ask you another thing. Notwithstanding which case and which position, you know that there are some scholars who argue that there's sort of a popular constitutionalism force going on. So to take things just to pick the left as opposed to the right, abortion rights or gay marriage actually is a better example. The sort of the public has, its support has grown. Do you think the court's calculus in terms of whether or not to overrule, assuming the switch, might be informed by the popular support for gay marriage or sexual freedom or other?
You mean if Trump were to get elected?
Say if Trump were to get elected and you have a 5-justice restoration of the conservative court, but realizing that, well, the people actually are okay with gay marriage, do you think they would hedge on whether to take that kind of case? And you could make the same hypo.
Yeah, you could reverse
with
it.
Clinton and a right-leaning issue.
I think it depends on personalities. I mean, I think it depends on who gets appointed. I don't know whether Hillary would go with somebody like Garland or would go with somebody more progressive. My guess is she would. Trump, I think, would try to appoint somebody pretty darn conservative and try to get it through Congress. Maybe an Alex Kaczynski on the Ninth Circuit.
Right.
Some personality like that could have a huge impact. Now, I think it'd be hard, given the movement in the gay and lesbian right area, to overrule those cases. I mean, I think public opinion is too much behind that now. But is it possible? Yeah, it's conceivable. I mean, the court has ignored public opinion in the past, or at least where public opinion wasn't clear. It's more clear now, I think, in some of these areas than it is in others. But the abortion thing is a good example. I mean, gun rights, I don't think public opinion is clear. It's probably divided. Probably Citizens United, you probably have more people that would prefer regulation of corporate expenditures. Roe versus Wade, the public opinion is about evenly divided, I think, on that one. And you know, that one would be an easier one to chip away at it over.
Right.
But I think that's a good point. I mean, I don't think the court is going to completely flaunt where the public is at. They've done it in the past, my God, in those New Deal cases. I mean, not only public opinion, but the political process was way.
Same thing could be said about Brown.
Right? Yeah, no, you could. I didn't say that, but you could say it.
Yeah, I mean. But we get the point, right?
Yeah,
there
are
places where public opinion.
Well, you could say the court wasn't behind, but was ahead in Brown versus the Board of the Education because the political process, like Kennedy said in Obergefell, is too slow, right? And that certainly could be true. The court could have been ahead in Roe versus Wade. I mean, there's there are other areas where they could have been ahead of public opinion, the political process, as opposed to being behind like they were in the early 20th century. Justin. Jason. All right.
Who do you think has been the most effective Supreme Court justice and why?
Oh, God, that's a great question. I don't know if I could give you one. I can give you examples of justices that I admire. Mm-hmm. Probably surprise you. I mean, I think... Two of my favorite justices in terms of their just sheer ability to write opinions, persuasive opinions, the second John Harlan and Robert Jackson, who was FDR's attorney general. Politically speaking, you know, I don't hide my politics in class or anywhere else. So politically speaking, you know, if I had to pick somebody, it would be a Douglas, a Stevens, somebody like that, I would think. You know, Stevens and actually David Souter, interesting. Souter also writes very good opinions, and you know, my politics and his are very consistent. Both Stevens and Souter are examples, like Eisenhower. I mean, like Warren. When Eisenhower appointed Warren, he thought he was a conservative, right? He was a former attorney general of California, then became governor. And he made the comment during the internment of the Japanese that we need to do it because they're so damn sneaky. I mean, he wasn't a liberal or progressive. He didn't seem to be. When Eisenhower appointed him, he completely changed. And Eisenhower said it was the worst mistake I ever made in politics. Stevens, appointed by Gerald Ford, I think, Republican president. Stevens, John Paul Stevens. But thought he was going to get a much more moderate, if not conservative, justice. And look what Stevens turned out to be. David Souter, H.W. Bush appointed him. Who turned out to be one of the more progressive members of the court.
Eisenhower appointed Brennan.
Yeah, that's right. Eisenhower appointed Brennan, too. So it's hard to answer that question. I really admire some of Harlan's language, and Robert Jackson wrote that concurring opinion in Youngstown Sheet and Tube versus Sawyer on separation of powers that still is always cited on the issue. Brilliant opinion. And Harlan wrote some great opinions, great language, too, in criminal procedure cases. Good question.
Hard to Stone, because we have his picture in the courtroom, Stone is one of the great justices of the Civil Court. And they all have had international shoes. The first year in your jurisdictions.
This is Professor McLaughlin. He's got much more longevity teaching criminal constitutional law than I do. I don't know where Professor Botten.
Picture, when you face the back of the courtroom, a picture of a judge standing there on the right side, is Harlan Stone, who was a Republican and one of the liberals on the court, and a great judge, the greatest judges ever.
Bob, who's your favorite?
No comment.
I'm going to put that on my gravestone. I've literally told my wife to put that on my grandma now. Sir.
You mentioned that after Marbury versus Madison, it was another 50 years the court refrained from using the power of judicial review. Like, at what point?
Congressional. Yeah.
At what point did the court become more liberal with that tactic to become more politically, you know, involved with decisions? And, like, I know you outlined, like, a history, but where was that, like, pivotal shift? And what was the reasoning for that? Like, was there, like, you know, was it civil rights? Was it, like, New Deal stuff? Like, when did they just explode?
It was the late. The, I don't know, Jim.
I would. Many laws in the
no, there was not. There was not much to overrule for one thing. I think the court in Dred Scott just thought they were going to solve the problem once and for all, and then just rule on it and be done. And of course, they were wrong. The court became most active probably in the late 19th century, early 20th, using the Commerce Clause to strike down congressional legislation. And using the Due Process Clause to strike down state legislation. That's the one that comes to mind, where you have probably the most political activity by the Supreme Court. And you have these, not all holdover justices, but older justices, who were fairly consistently in favor of market economics, laissez-faire. Government ought to stay out of it. Government shouldn't regulate it. You know, they were making constitutional decisions based on politics and not so much law. Constitutional law is law in politics. You'll find that out next semester when you take the course. In the federal courts course, it's law, politics, and civil procedure, so you get a threefer there. But,